Urban II. The Pope made an announcement at the Council of Clermont, which convened under his leadership. He claimed that holy sites in the East had been disrespected and that Christian pilgrims had been assaulted. He called all of Europe to wage war under a single banner. The fact is, however, that these claims were a complete violation of the truth. The Christians of the Middle East were living in freedom and toleration, and were fully able to practice their beliefs. In fact, the pretext for war was merely an excuse. Both the Pope and those who heeded his call actually had very different expectations from the war. The historian Donald Keller describes this in these terms. The French knights wanted more land. Italian merchants hoped to expand trade in Middle Eastern ports. Large numbers of poor people joined the expeditions simply to escape the hardships of their normal lives. In order to increase the effect of his words, the Pope also told the lie that the sins of all those who joined in the war would be forgiven. His words served their purpose. Caught up in a wave of fervor, his listeners emblazoned their garments with the fabric crosses distributed to them. Within a very short space of time, that call had an extraordinary effect all over Europe. A large army was formed. These people, who called themselves the Crusaders, looted a great many places on their journey and finally met up in Constantinople. The Crusaders then began moving through Anatolia. After putting the Muslims whose gold and jewels they dreamed of finding to the sword and pillaging their cities, they reached Jerusalem, where the Crusaders' savagery continued. They slaughtered all the Muslims and Jews in the city, sparing neither women nor children. In his book, The Monks of War, the researcher Desmond Seward describes that savagery thus. Jerusalem was stormed in July 1099. The entire population of the holy city was put to the sword, Jews as well as Muslims. 70,000 men, women, and children perished in a holocaust which raged for 3 days. In places, men waded in blood up to their ankles, and horsemen were splashed by it as they rode through the streets. After capturing Jerusalem, the Crusaders made it their own capital, establishing a Latin empire, the borders of which stretched from Palestine to Antioch. They needed to organize if the state they had founded were to survive. To that end, they set up military orders. The members of these orders lived a monastic life on the one hand, and were trained to wage war against Muslims on the other. One of these orders were the Templars. The Templar cult was thus born in the Holy Land, in Jerusalem. The founders of the order received great support from the Crusader king in Jerusalem. The king endowed them with a most sacred site, the hill where the Temple of Solomon had once stood. The building of the temple had begun in the time of the prophet David and continued after his death under his son, the prophet Solomon. This temple was eventually torn down and a new temple erected on the same spot by the Jewish king Herod. That second temple was torn down by the Roman Empire in 70 AD. The Romans initiated a major attack against the Jews and expelled them from the region. A thousand years came and went. Although the Al-Aqsa Mosque now stood in the place formerly occupied by the temple, the area still bore deep traces of Jewish esotericism. When the Templars installed themselves on the hill where the Temple of Solomon had once stood, it had a profound effect on them, and they began examining it. These researches led them to remains which contained the essence of some secret traditions to the heart of ancient Jewish belief. They encountered a teaching which constituted the pagan aspect of ancient Jewish belief, the Kabbalah. The origins of the Kabbalah go back to ancient Egypt, and it has constituted the basis of all kinds of magic ritual and secret sciences. The mystic teaching in these lands, under whose spell the Templars fell, reshaped their beliefs and ways of living. No matter how much they still maintained the external appearance of warrior Christian monks, among themselves they had secretly adopted the Kabbalist philosophy and way of life. In his book, Morals and Dogma, Grandmaster Albert Pike, one of the best-known names in Freemasonry, sets out the Templars' true objective. The avowed object of the Templars was to protect the Christians who came to visit the holy places. Their secret object was the rebuilding of the Temple of Solomon. The object of the Templars, he said, was to acquire influence and wealth, then to intrigue and at need fight to establish the Kabbalistic dogma. The Templars had a very strict chain of command. Everything belonged to the order. Marriage, owning a house, and enjoying family relations were all forbidden. They wore only a white robe with a red cross on it, and never washed. Their seal was a figure of two knights riding the same horse. Although they maintained that this symbolized brotherhood, in fact, it had another secret meaning. According to a widespread belief, this symbol represented homosexuality, a perverted element in the Templars' private lives. By 1186, the Templars' last days in Jerusalem were approaching. A Muslim army under Saladin had inflicted a heavy defeat on the Crusaders. Moving through Palestine, Saladin eventually captured Jerusalem. The Crusader armies had gravely oppressed the Muslims during their 100 years in the region. The people of Jerusalem were alarmed. They were terrified the Muslims would seek their revenge. Yet they were in for a great surprise. Saladin did not harm the civilian population. Moreover, he pardoned the majority of the Christians he captured. Only the Templars were executed for the slaughter they had carried out. King Richard I, the so-called hero, known by the name of Lionheart in British history, was in fact a ruthless murderer. In 1191, he had ruthlessly beheaded 3,000 Muslims, including large numbers of women and children, in Acre Castle. At the same time, Richard was the Templars' closest friend. Following the loss of the Holy Land, the Templars needed a temporary headquarters. King Richard did what was expected of him. He sold the island of Cyprus to the Templars at a very reasonable price. According to historical sources, the Templars were very good sailors. During their time in the Holy Land, they had learned the sciences of geometry and mathematics from Jewish and Arab sources, and also acquired a number of maps. In this way, they sailed the coasts of Europe and Africa, and were even able to voyage to far-off waters. Such famous explorers as Vasco da Gama and Christopher Columbus were both actually Templars. The main aim of their overseas travels was, according to one interpretation, to seek new sources of income and new trade routes to bring the Templars further material power. The red crosses on the sails of their ships were the same as the cross figure employed by the Templars. After the loss of Jerusalem, the Templars set sail for Europe. Emerging as the poor fellow soldiers of Christ, the Knights Templars gradually became the wealthiest people in Europe, as well as prominent bankers and statesmen. They turned into a major economic force, offering banking services, transferring funds, opening lines of credit, and receiving interest. Although usury was forbidden, they had no compunctions about charging interest on the money they lent. The fact is, however, that interest is clearly unlawful in all the revealed religions. God reveals this in the Quran. Those who devour usury will not rise from the grave except as someone driven mad by Satan's touch. That is because they say, trade is the same as usury. But God has permitted trade, and He has forbidden usury. Whoever is given a warning by his Lord and then desists can keep what he received in the past, and his affair is God's concern. But all who return to it will be the companions of the fire, remaining in it timelessly forever. The researchers Alan Butler and Stephen Defoe describe the money-lending aspect of the organization in these terms. The Templars were expert financiers, using trading techniques quite unknown in the Europe of their day. They had clearly learned many of these skills from Jewish sources, but would have much more freedom to extend their financial empire in a way that any Jewish financier of the period would have envied greatly. They owned hundreds of castles in Europe. Furthermore, most kings of the time were in debt to them. One source describes the material power of the Templars in the following terms. The throne of England was seriously indebted to the order. King John had emptied the coffers of the treasury between 1260 and 1266 in order to finance his military operations, and Henry III, likewise, borrowed heavily from the Knights Templar. This power made the Templars very influential in a great many areas. For instance, when Innocent II was elected Pope with their support, the first privilege he gave the Templars was the right to build and run their own churches. At the same time, this meant an architecture with which they could freely reflect their own worldview. With that in mind, they developed their own individual style of building, Gothic architecture. The Templars increasingly moved away from the religious beliefs and practices of the Church. The philosophy and way of life, which they had maintained in secret right from the outset, slowly came to light. Rumors of their deviant lifestyles spread. The perversions going on in the private castles in which the Templars shut themselves for their secret ceremonies made both the people and all the kings of Europe, especially the King of France, most uneasy. The new Pope was now certain that this group, over which he was unable to establish any authority, lived an irreligious life and needed to be eliminated. In October 1307, King Philip of France and Pope Clement V decided to arrest the Knights Templar. Some members of the order were thrown into prison. Others were executed. One of those executed was Grand Master Jacques de Molay. Under a decree by Pope Clement V and the King of France, published on March 22, 1312, the Templars were declared to be dissolved, and the order was erased from the official records. Those members of the order who were caught made frightening confessions during 5 years of interrogations. It emerged from these confessions that the Templars entirely rejected God and the theistic religions, and that they were devoted to the perversion of devil worship, these days known as Satanism. They worshipped a goat-headed figure by the name of Baphomet. regarded as the source of evil in black magic. The order had continued its devil-worshipping ceremonies in the greatest secrecy for hundreds of years. Furthermore, disrespect for religious symbols regarded as sacred by all Christians had become a ritual element of those ceremonies. The last person to preside over these ceremonies was Grand Master Jacques de Molay. The churches constructed by the Templars were evidence of the pagan relief they had adopted. This is Roslyn Chapel near Edinburgh, one of the Templar churches. Pagan motifs reflecting pagan beliefs are carved all over it. The Templar seal in one corner of the chapel, the same figure of two knights on one horse. A representation of the devilish figure Baphomet and other mystical symbols denoting pagan beliefs. These symbols would later appear in Masonic lodges. The following words about Roslyn Chapel appeared in Mimar Sinan, the magazine for members of Turkish Masonic lodges. There are so many pagan decorative elements inside the chapel that in his memoirs about the baptism he performed of the Baron of Roslyn in 1589, a priest complained, "Because the chapel is filled with pagan idols, there is no place appropriate to administer the sacrament." In August 31, 1592, as a result of pressure exerted on Baron Oliver St. Clair of Roslyn, the chapel's pagan-style altar was destroyed. The Templars officially disappeared, although they actually survived in secret. A number of knights who had evaded capture fled to the only European kingdom in 14th century Europe which did not recognize the Catholic Church, Scotland. At that time, the Scots were at war with the English. The Templars acquired considerable freedom by siding with the Scots during that conflict. They infiltrated the Stonemason Guilds, one of the most influential civil society organizations of the time. Later on, these guilds acquired a political and philosophical identity and turned into secret Masonic lodges. That is how the transition from the operative masonry to speculative masonry took place, according to Masonic sources. It is for these reasons that the Scottish Rite, the first Masonic lodge established by the Templars in Scotland, is the oldest known branch of Freemasonry. There is a striking similarity between the two organizations. When we compare Masonic ritual and symbolism with those of the Templars, a number of common features are readily apparent. The use of the Temple of Solomon, regarded as the fundamental symbol in Freemasonry, Master Hiram, the chief builder of the temple according to the Old Testament, the profession of stonemasonry, and similar symbols based on the Old Testament and Kabbalistic teachings, ceremonies, vows, and a great many other practices all go back to the Templar tradition. These are some of the principal symbols of Freemasonry. The set square and compasses were used by master stonemasons. For that reason, they bear a special significance for both Masons and Knights Templars, with their common history. One can also find such similarities in their organizational structures. The names given to the highest-ranking figures in the Scottish Rite in Freemasonry are such titles as Knight of the Temple, Protector of the Temple, and Knight of Vengeance, given to members of the Templar Order centuries ago. When the Templars turned into Freemasonry, they once again possessed a powerful organization. At the same time, they began to spread rapidly throughout Europe with the perfect camouflage this gave them. As well as Freemasonry, the Templars also established the Rose Croix organization. The main focus of this organization was alchemy and magic. In one source, the relationship between the Rose Croix and the Templars is set out as follows. The Rosy Cross derived from the Red Cross of the Templars. Mirabeau, who as a Freemason and an Illuminatus was in a position to discover many facts about the secret societies of Germany during his stay in the country, definitely asserts that the Rose Croix Masons of the 17th century were only the ancient order of the Templars secretly perpetuated. One of the most famous members of the Rose Croix was the English statesman and thinker Sir Francis Bacon, who was also a Grand Master of the English Templars. Bacon set out the state structure of which the Templars dreamed in his book, The New Atlantis. The main aim of their work was to rule the world by using the mystical powers in Templar teaching. Another organization set up by the Templars in addition to the Rose Croix was the secret Illuminati Society. The leader of the organization was a fanatical atheist, Adam Weishaupt. All these organizations, run behind the scenes by the Templars, had a common objective: to destroy religious beliefs and to impose on the world the atheist and materialist worldview of the Templars' anti-religious philosophy. To that end, the first great socialist movement was prepared and put into action. That was the French Revolution. Count Cagliostro, who played a behind-the-scenes role in the revolution, was a Mason. Cagliostro's aim was the one-by-one elimination of all the existing monarchies in Europe by spreading revolutionary ideas and inciting revolt. Given the role of agent by the lodge, Cagliostro confessed all when he was caught. In his confession, he stated that the Masons planned to spread the revolution to all of Europe and that their objective was to complete the half-finished work of the Templars and to destroy the church and all religious beliefs. With the French Revolution, there began a period of terror led by the Jacobins, most of whom were Masons. Tens of thousands of people were sent to the guillotine, especially men of religion and supporters of the monarchy. The French king was executed. As he was being guillotined, one of the onlookers shouted, "De Molay, you have been avenged." After a gap of some 400 years, the Templars have taken revenge for their grandmaster Jacques de Molay and their other brothers who had been burned alive. But this was to be neither the first nor the last. One important link in the chain of the Masons' illegal political activities was the famous Jack the Ripper murders. These serial killings took place in London in 1888. Over a period of 9 weeks, 5 prostitutes were savagely killed, their bodies slashed to pieces. The killer was never found. However, some researchers who examined the events obtained proof that these murders had a political significance and that, furthermore, they were coordinated by a secret organization. The famous author Stephen Knight unveiled this proof in his book, Jack the Ripper, The Final Solution. According to Knight, that organization was the Freemasons. The latest development to bring that view back onto the agenda was the 2001 Hollywood film, From Hell. Made in the light of the historical facts, the film set out the relationship between the Jack the Ripper murders and Freemasonry. As the film shows, at the time the killings were carried out, the British monarchy was on the brink of a terrible scandal. The heir to the throne had married a prostitute. If word of that were to leak out, this would represent a terrible danger, both to the monarchy and to the Masons. The Masons, who controlled all the organs of the state, savagely killed the woman and other of her prostitute friends in order to eliminate that danger. The people responsible for the killings were all Masons, for which reason everything was covered up. The series of killings went down on record as being the work of a woman-hating madman. In the film From Hell, a secret meeting of Masons of the time was reenacted.
Who is this?
Who are you?
is in a state of darkness. He comes of his own free will, perfectly prepared, humbly soliciting to be admitted to the mysteries and privileged.
The film also depicted the induction of a new member of the sect and the initiation ceremony inside the lodge.
How did he find out about the unfortunate man, Charles?
He has that kind of cleverness you sometimes find in the middle classes. A cheap sort of intelligence, but effective, nevertheless.
Never to reveal our secrets, under no less a penalty than my throat be cut across. My tongue be torn out by its root, and that I be buried in sand, a cable's length from shore.
The Jack the Ripper murders are important proof of the power wielded by the Masons in the organs of the state.
No, he's not that foolish.
Let the brother receive the light.
An event which took place in 1981 again brought Freemasonry into the public eye. Police officials conducting an investigation in Italy obtained a list of members of the Propaganda du Masonic Lodge, P2 for short. That list contained the names of senior civil servants, the police chiefs of four large Italian cities, industrialists, financiers, the editors of a famous newspaper, and TV stars. The name at the top of the list was that of Licio Gelli. Gelli was a militant fascist, a fierce supporter of Mussolini, who had shed blood in the fascist ranks during the Spanish Civil War. He was now Grand Master of the P2 Lodge. The investigators revealed that the Lodge played a major role in the running of the state, was involved in a large part of the corruption in Italy, and even that it was the most powerful arm of the Italian Mafia. P2 was the main player in a number of bombings and assassinations, and enjoyed close relations with the famous Gladio organization. Documents collected by the Parliamentary Investigation Commission revealed that P2 was an international organization influential in all fields, from arms trading to crude oil prices. The Italian press devoted considerable space to P2's illegal activities. The P2 Lodge continued the Masonic tradition with the strange ceremonies it practiced, as well as with its political activities. Following the corruption scandals with their links to Freemasonry, Operation Clean Hands was launched, though to no avail. The Masons knew all too well how to cover their tracks. P2 is only one example of the way the Masons organize inside the state. There are hundreds of Masonic lodges all over the world, which secretly carry out illegal activities which never come to light. The ultimate aim of all these is the ideal of Masonic world domination, which they have inherited from the Templars. What we have seen in this film shows that the course of history and current events are different to how they sometimes appear, and that there are dark aims behind processes and events which are assumed to have come about naturally. As God reveals in the Quran in Surah 16, there are those who plot evil actions, and these sometimes have a greater influence than is supposed. The Knights Templars, who are one of these, never disappeared, and they still exist today, although in the form of Freemasons. Lodges, which still meet today in America under the name of the Knights Templars, are active as a branch of Freemasonry. The Templars, who go under different names and guises, but who all act with the same aim in mind, are trying to change the direction of the world in line with their own interests by increasing their own power. They have used all possible methods to that end, and are still doing so today. The fundamental objective of the activities they pursue under the name of Freemasonry is to spread the outdated materialist philosophy they have inherited from pagan beliefs by doing away with the divine religions. That is why they support such atheistic ideas as Darwin's theory of evolution, materialism, and humanism, and seek to use a wide range of concepts, including science, art, the media, literature, and music for their own ends. In the Quran, God describes those who oppose the true religion and proper moral values as corruptors and describes their end thus. As for those who did not believe and barred access to the way of God, we will heap punishment on top of their punishment because of the corruption they brought about. The duty of all people of good conscience in the face of such dark forces which organize corruption and wage a systematic campaign against religion and believers is to engage in an intellectual struggle. The solution to the erroneous philosophies which these dark forces would impose on mankind lies in the moral values of the Quran. Believers who fulfill that responsibility achieve the honor of being a means whereby God's promise in the Quran will come about. Rather, we hurl the truth against falsehood, and it cuts right through it, and it vanishes clean away. Woe without end for you, for what you portray.